Subscribe to The Honest Critique for current affairs, movie, book, and product reviews. Also, make sure you press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video. The views, information, or opinions expressed during the video series are solely those of the individuals and do not necessarily represent those of The Honest Critique and its employees. The following video contains strong language which may be offensive to some viewers. Viewer discretion advised.
So hello and welcome to a very special episode we are recording today. I'm delighted to be joined by Dr. Eyal Hulata, who is the former National Security Advisor and former head of Israel's National Security Council. So thank you so much, sir, for taking your time and speaking to us.
Welcome.
I wanted to start the conversation by one of the press briefing that I was watching yesterday of yours. And you mentioned about Israel's current ground maneuvers in Gaza, which are aimed at degrading Hamas's capabilities. So let's start with that, actually, with the ground offensives. As we see that the ground offensive starts, and those are somewhat targeted, could you provide a little more details about the specific objectives and strategies behind this military operations?
Yeah, so the military operation is, of course, started after the surprise attack of Hamas on our civilians, on our communities. Tomorrow it will be 4 weeks since that attack. And the objectives of the government are very clear. We need to remove Hamas from its ability to do this again. Hamas chose to use its full brutality and all of its means to murder and snatch babies, women, elderly, of course, men, soldiers in large quantities in a way that Israel cannot allow to sustain that threat on our borders. So this is the objective of what we're doing. Of course, it's very, very difficult to do that because Hamas is embedded in civilian population and it's using its own population as human shields. Israel has called for the evacuation of northern Gaza, which is a war zone, of all the people to move to the south. And to also Israel is providing and assisting in the providing of humanitarian aid in the south of Gaza. Hamas did not allow all of the people to move to southern of Gaza because they need human shields, because otherwise they know that we will more freely get them. They have tunnels. They have taken resources from the civilian population to use to sustain this war. So it's very difficult to fight such a terror organization in those constraints. But this is what we need to do. So those are the objectives of what we're doing. We're doing it very carefully and very slowly because we're trying to minimize civilian casualties to the extent possible. And as you can see, still, there are civilian casualties, of course, because this is war embedded in civilian population. But I think the IDF is doing its utmost to try to prevent that. And the outcome of that is that we're moving very, very slowly, very carefully, and it will take time until we reach those objectives. Of course, another objective is to release all of the hostages. There are more than 240 hostages still there. It's a terrible scar in the Israeli population and society, and we have to resolve this as well. And the third objective is to restore the sense of security to our people. About 200,000 Israelis left their homes from around the Gaza Strip because it is a war zone. And for them to come back, they need to know that they can continue to live safely and that their kids are not in danger by militants and terrorists from the other side of the fence.
And this brings me to what I wanted to ask you about. You mentioned about the challenges associated with an operation of this scale, especially what we've seen, the reaction from the international community. We have seen the UN, for example, has been met with several criticism by the Israeli government for how it has reacted to this. How do you believe these external factors will be influencing the situation on ground and impact they could have on Israel's decision-making? We've seen it took a while for those ground offensives to actually begin, and still it's not on full force, actually. It's still targeted operations. Are the international pressure mounting on Israel to actually minimize the ground operations for now?
So first of all, I have to say that the fact that it took long to start is because we needed to redo all of our planning given the circumstances on the ground. And the fact that it's moving slow, as you said, and not a full mounting ground operation is because Israel abides the rules, because this is what we do all the time. I know that we're getting criticized by the international community that we conduct war crimes, but this isn't true. On the contrary, it's our enemies that conduct war crimes, get into our communities, and murder civilians intentionally. I wish our communities got an advance warning like we gave the Gazans before we got into a war zone. So first and foremost, we're doing this because this is the way Israel conducts its military activities in this regard. Unfortunately, there is a mounting international criticism. Part of it has to do with the humanitarian situation in Gaza, which I think is important, and Israel needs to do its utmost to have a relief to civilian population in southern Gaza. We're providing water and we're allowing all of the trucks with medicine and food and clothes and shelters to get to the civilian population. Israel is trying to block tankers with diesel because we know that Hamas is taking that diesel. They're not using it for humanitarian purposes. They're taking it so that they can activate electricity in their tunnels for the air supply and all of the others. So we are stubborn about that, and I think that rightly so. As for the UN, look, unfortunately, Israel has no expectations of that institution. This the UN is unbalanced and biased against Israel all the time in all of the votes. In completely unjustified numbers and reasoning. So you know it's quite a pity that the UN is not capable in understanding that from time to time, I think many more times, but especially in occasions such as October 7th, Israel is actually right. We have been brutalized, butchered, and the fact that they cannot say that Hamas is a terrorist organization and that this attack must be condemned is really a pity. I think the international community in general needs to say that. We're very happy, by the way, by the fact that the Indian government and Prime Minister Narendra Modi is empathic to the pain of the Israelis and understands, because India also understands what happens when terror goes through your streets unattained. And you're a much larger country than us, and your population is much larger. But you know exactly what it means when terrorists brutalizes your streets. And we appreciate the relationship with India in this regard. Unfortunately, we cannot say that for many more countries around the world, and especially as it happens in the UN General Assembly in previous weeks.
And I wanted to understand something which you actually mentioned. You mentioned of this concept called the diplomatic clock, actually, while you're referring to this. Could you explain what it means and how it factors to Israel's decision-making regarding the conflict right now?
So what happened in previous wars and conflicts that we had, that in a certain amount of time, the international community started pressuring Israeli government to achieve a ceasefire, usually before we were able to achieve our fundamental goals. This happened in the second Lebanese war in 2006. It happened in Protective Edge in Gaza in 2014. And I envision that this can happen again. My argument is that Israel needs to understand that and to act more swiftly and decisively so we can take better use of the time that we have and achieve goals and gain that we need properly. I think that while we do this, we actually can extend the international clock. If Israel is cognizant of the humanitarian crisis in south of Gaza and provides the aid it should, this hopefully should allow the international community to understand that Israel is actually doing its most to achieve its goals with little damage as possible to the civilian population in Gaza. This is very difficult to achieve. You need to understand that it's not in the interest of Hamas that the world knows that Israel conducts by the rules of the international law and also is cognizant of the humanitarian crisis, because for Hamas, this is exactly the picture they want to put out. So when a rocket by Palestinians hit the hospital, they lie to the international community and say that it was us who did it, and also lie about the numbers of people who were killed in that attack. They don't allow their people to go to the south so that they can have human shields. And it's not in their interest that everybody will know that trucks actually go into south of Gaza with the humanitarian aid. Unfortunately, they lie time after time after time. And I hope that, you know, at least your audience can understand that this is the situation where it really is. This is what Israel is actually doing. And this is important so we can have the time we need to maneuver, because we have to eliminate Hamas rule of Gaza. Not only can they not be neighboring to Israel, putting danger to our civilians, they're also endangering their own people. They're endangering 2.5 Palestinians in Gaza, not allowing them to enjoy what could be of a more normal life. Israel withdrew from Gaza completely. We no longer govern Gaza. You know, people don't remember that, or perhaps they don't know this, but we evacuated from Gaza in 2005. For the last 18 years, Gaza has no Israeli control over it. Of course, Hamas is controlling it, attacking us, so we need to respond. But this is reality as it is.
And how long do you think, from your experience, will the international community allow, for example, the airstrikes to continue or the ground siege to continue, provided that there is a huge amount of pressure building up, probably with the death toll mounted?
Yeah.
Of course, the figures are coming from the Gazan Health Ministry, which is run by the Hamas. But how long do you think the Israel has the time to act?
So we're getting more support from the international community than previous rounds in Gaza, I think, because the international community understands that what the brutality of October 7th, the numbers, the images, I think the international community, the leaders of the Western world and the democracies in the world understand that we actually need to get rid of Hamas, and we're getting more support than before. How will that play out in terms of time? It's difficult to know. I don't expect that we will be allowed for months and months of attacks. I would expect it will happen shorter than that. It also depends on how Israel acts and conducts its operation. But as I wrote in an article, I believe that the numbers are weeks and not months.
So this actually brings me to one of the things that I wanted to ask you before I move on from this. Is a ceasefire an option at this point of time? Because there was a ceasefire before October 7th as well. And we have seen multiple rounds of fire exchanges between Israel and Hamas for quite some time, not just right now. It's been years and years of amount of days where we have seen fire exchange, and after that there has been again a ceasefire, and after that again been attacks. But is ceasefire an option that Israel might be considering right now, or they would want Hamas to go away completely?
Look, I think at this point, a ceasefire just played to the hand of Hamas. This is their victory, right? They were able to slaughter all of our people. We did not get the hostages back. And their leadership continues to walk freely in Gaza. This is demanding from Israel a ceasefire under these conditions is like demanding Israel to surrender to Hamas. Israel cannot accept that. I would expect that if a negotiation to release of all of the hostages can materialize, Israel will consider to end this at this point, and argue that bringing back the hostages, all of them, is more important at this point than getting to the last of Hamas leaders. We can do that later, and I hope that actually this comes. But I'm not sure that Hamas is willing to do that. I think Hamas thinks that they have the upper hand. I'm not sure that they want a ceasefire at this point. Of course, they want Israel to surrender. That they want, but they don't want a ceasefire that is giving us what we need, right? In terms of getting the hostages. So as long as this happens, there's no reason to stop the firing, unfortunately. But it's in Hamas' hands even more than in Israel's hands.
This is why I think we should move a little bit to the regional actors that play into the game. And one of those things that I wanted to ask you is the axis of resistance, which has started acting and helping the Hamas out here. We have seen, for example, the Houthis have started the attacks, and General Nasrullah is supposed to speak on Friday. So we can only kind of anticipate right now, but Hezbollah has not actively joined, but there has been some round of exchanges between Hezbollah and Israel for a while. How do you see the regional dynamics play into the conflict going from here?
Right. Yeah, so that's a very good question, because clearly the game is way more broader and complicated than just the direct conflict between Israel and Hamas. Because behind this strategy of surrounding Israel with terror proxies that can attack us and try to find opportunities to get us undefended, as unfortunately they did, is Iran, right? Iran has armed, financed, trained, and directed Hezbollah, the Houthis in Yemen, and of course also Hamas. And you know, there is a debate in the international field whether or not Iran has specifically directed Hamas to start the firing. I think it is of complete irrelevance. Iran is the sole beneficiary of that. Iran wanted to derail the normalization process between Israel and Saudi Arabia, and unfortunately they managed to do this, at least temporarily. And Iran has all of the interests that Israel will be busy confronting those organizations as proxies instead of attacking them, or you know, taking care of the real problem, which is inside of Iran. So this is how this plays out. I think Iran knows that if Hezbollah joins the war right now, Lebanon will be damaged severely, and also Hezbollah will be damaged severely. And I don't think that Iran wants to lose another key factor or key element that they have in the region as Hezbollah. This doesn't mean that tomorrow, I mean, I expect tomorrow in Nasrallah's speech, he will speak very strongly and he will say that Israel is weak and the Americans are weak and that, you know, Israel threatened and America threatened, but he will be the one that decides when and when to act. Well, you know, it will be a show, but the truth is that he did not join the war and he has good reasons for that because he knows what will happen if he does join the war. The Houthis is a different story. But I guess Iran, when they see that Hamas is incapable of increasing or extending the war, the West Bank is quiet. The Arab-Israeli population who joined Hamas back in 21 did not join in riots and fighting in this term. And Hamas alone cannot defeat Israel. So I guess they thought that Houthis can start firing rockets in Israel from afar. It's more difficult for Israel to strike back on Houthis. And it's also defying the Americans who said that no one should join take the opportunity of this conflict and join. Well, Iran decided to have the Houthis join, and this defies the American threat. And it will be interesting to see how the Americans respond to this. But it's very difficult for the Houthis to actually cause damage to Israel. It's more of a nuance, I think, than anything else. Israel needs to focus on its objectives. Hamas is what we need to eliminate first. And then later, we need to deal with the other Iranian threats. And eventually, we need to ensure that Iran cannot gain a nuclear weapon. This will be a completely destabilizing effect on the entire region. I think also on India, this will have an effect. If the Shiites of Iran have obtained a nuclear weapon, this will stabilize the entire region. And hopefully, we can join forces together on that, because that's a mutual target that we all need to take care of.
And while we talk about Iran, for example, one of the things that we miss talking about, and I've seen this conversation even while I've spoken to other people, it's not been spoken a lot, is about Qatar, actually, in this condition. I don't want to make it a little political, but even the current dispensation that's there, I saw the National Security Advisor praising the Qatari for their mediation efforts. But while the Qatar actually has funded Hamas over the period of time and even host Hamas, yeah, the political leadership. So when are we actually keep making Qatar responsibility, holding them accountable for what is right, going on?
I completely agree with you. And, you know, my personal view, and I think the professional view in Israel is that Qatar must be held accountable for what they did. I mean, it's true that Israel was aided by Qatar to assist the humanitarian situation in Gaza over the years. And I think that was a good decision to be made. But the Qataris played a double game. And while they were assisting with us the humanitarian situation, they also assisted the military branch. And they did not respond to pressure by Israel, by the international community, to stop from that. And actually, you know, held us hostages of our own policies while they did that. I think what they're trying to do now is they're trying to make the world believe that they are okay, right? That they can broker a hostages deal. My successor's tweet on Qatar was in the context of an attempt to release the hostages. And I think that releasing hostages is a noble cause and that we should do that. And I guess in that context, he put his tweet out. I don't want to say what I think directly on this because I don't want to make this personal. I think in general, first, we need to find out that this didn't work, right? I mean, the Qataris did not broker a deal and the hostages are not released. And quite frankly, they're not doing enough to do that. So I think they deserve all of the criticism that they should get. And they should be held accountable by the international community. And if they want to be rehabilitated, they do need to do much more to pressure Hamas, to have the hostages released, and to change the conditions on the ground so that the Palestinian people in Gaza that they claim that they care so much about are better off.
And how about someone, for example, like Egypt or Jordan in this equation? How do they play an important role? Because both of them have very problematic responses while it comes to the conflict as well.
Yes, it's true. Unfortunately, it's true. I'm very much agonized to hear that the palace in Jordan release a statement by Queen Rania that Israel does not have a right for self-defense because what she claims is Israel being an occupier. We're not occupying of Gaza at all. And this is completely untrue and unjustified. And yet again, the palace allowed themselves to say that. You know, I can understand The political problems that Jordan is going through, a large Palestinian population in Gaza, including the Queen herself, and you know they are probably angry, but what Israel is doing, but this does not should not blind them, and they should call it as it is. And Hamas was a terror organization, and unfortunately, the same for Egypt. I mean, Egypt knows exactly what Hamas can do. I think Egypt is worried that Hamas will turn against Egypt. And after seeing them brutalize the Israelis, they must think what could happen if Hamas turned against Egypt. Egypt has a severe problem with Islamic Brotherhood, and Hamas is Islamic Brotherhood. So, you know, they have a serious problem. And it's difficult for them to weigh between that and supporting Israel. Unfortunately, they never supported Israel, and I don't expect them to. I do expect them on the ground to do more serious stuff. To limit Hamas' ability to endanger also them. It's their national security interests that Hamas ceases to govern Gaza. And unfortunately, they're not doing enough to that end. And that's very unfortunate because ultimately it will turn against them.
A couple of questions I wanted to ask you on what happened on October 7th, the intelligence failure, actually. This is something that I wanted to ask you before I end the conversation is, you have been in government for around from 2021 to 2023. And much has been criticized about how Israel underplayed the Hamas challenge, actually, the threat that Hamas posed. And that's where, since it underplayed, it didn't have sufficient measure to deter the when it came on October 7th. Take us through about what led to the attacks on October 7th. Was it just intelligence failure, or was it a larger implication of the policy and how Israel is dealing with Hamas?
Yeah, so unfortunately, I think it's a much wider failure than just the intelligence failure. The intelligence failure is severe, and Hamas was able to deceive our intelligence sensors and collections, and they must have known much more than we anticipated about our collection efforts, and were able to create a counter intelligence campaign that was very successful and put us completely blinded as to their intentions, especially as it comes to the timing, because we knew they had plans. But in intelligence, what you need is to know when, not only what. And they were completely able to blind us on the when question. I think also on the width of this attack also. But it's way wider than that, because you know Israel knows that we can be surprised by our aggressors and our enemies. And Israel needs to conduct a defense capabilities to be able to withstand such a surprise, and we failed to do that. And we failed to do that because of decision making levels coming all the way from the top. How do we evaluate the risk even if there is no intelligence? How worried are we that Hamas will try to take an opportunity while we are weak, because Israel has suffered for the beginning of the year under this government a lot of friction internally, and our society was fractured, and a lot of problems internally were there. The government must have understood that this can be turned into opportunistic thinking of our adversaries, and this was debated. So you know it clearly was there, and unfortunately the government failed to understand that this can happen, and to instruct the military to be more careful, even if they don't have the intel to provide to them. And other than that, I think for indeed for years Israel, because Israel is not looking for wars. And you know we're not searching for an opportunity to attack our enemies. We did, hopefully, thought that Hamas can might be able to worry more for its own population than trying to implement their ideology to murder Jews. Unfortunately, we were wrong about Hamas. You know, and I'm part of it. I was national security advisor. I was also hoping that through various policies we can ease the situation in Gaza enough so that Hamas won't have the incentive to attack us. But Hamas, being a brutal terrorist organization, they were not looking for opportunities to make it better for their people. They were looking for opportunities to butcher us. And that was a mistake. And this is why Hamas must be removed, because they are clearly cannot be a partner to anything and to anyone. And nobody should be partnered with Hamas. And I'm very angry when Erdogan decides to support Hamas and say that they are not a terrorist organization, while we're trying also to amend our relationship with Turkey, for instance, another country that we didn't cover in this interview. So this is the reality of things. Indeed, yes, Israel has failed. Israel perhaps has failed because it was hoping that things can be better in the Middle East in this regard. By the way, I still hope that things can be better in the Middle East, but not with Hamas. Hamas must be rid of, and hopefully there could be more pragmatic forces leading the Palestinian people that will take care of the Palestinians more than they want to murder us. And if that will happen, maybe there will be a circumstance in the future where we can have a better situation on the ground, but not with Hamas, unfortunately. They have proven to be a brutal, murderous, immoral organization that all they care about is to murder Jews.
But even if we consider for a second, actually, that there was a certain lack of intelligence on that particular day, or for a while at least, but is an excuse that even the defense capabilities that took time to even respond to the situation, that was also lacking. And some of the experts have mentioned that it was also because a lot of attention was given to the West Bank and the Gaza Strip was left open, yeah. Actually. Was that also one of the reasons that this could escalate to a point that it just not only that the Hamas didn't just broke open the gates, actually, they came inside the kibbutz, attacked people, took so many hostages.
Yes. Yeah, you're totally right. And this is what I meant when I said that it is the responsibility of the leadership to make sure that the defenses are prepared even if there is no intel calling. And clearly, the policies of the government were different. And they forced the need to have more soldiers in the West Bank than around Gaza. And not enough soldiers were around to do this. And this is clearly a failure of the IDF to respond properly in time, and of the leadership that allowed this to deteriorate to this situation. I agree with you. This is a disaster. You know, I cannot shy away of this. This shouldn't have happened to us. The IDF should be better than that. Our intelligence should be better than that. Our country should be better than that. And you know, sometimes we get those wake up calls to make us understand that we may think that we're good and strong, but actually we're not. And this came in time where Israel knew that we were weak from within, unfortunately. And this is the outcome of that. And this is very frustrating because this shouldn't have happened. It will take a long time to amend the fractures and the wounds from this to the Israeli society and people.
You interestingly mentioned actually about Turkey, and I wanted to have a couple of last questions. One of them was I wanted to warn about Hamas actually. In particular, and for example, countries like Turkey or Qatar, which actually legitimizes an organization like Hamas, actually, in this point that it has a political leadership. And that's why somewhat even the Israeli leadership thought into account as well, because when you were also the National Security Advisor, Operation Breaking Dawn happened, the Palestinian Islamic Jihad actually launched attack. The Hamas did not get involved in that at all. When you had a view what we're looking at from your seat in the last 2 years when Hamas did not actively engage, was there a thought that probably they would want the civil benefits for their own citizens out there, and that's the reason they would not choose to attack Israel because they have much to lose than actually to go and attack Israel?
So this is what we thought, and this is why we acted the way we acted. We were thinking and hoping that, as you said, Hamas was more interested in alleviating the well-being of its own people than attacking us. But it might be very unfortunately true that Hamas decided not to attack then because they wanted the element of surprise to conduct this attack. And then, you know, this is part of what we need to understand in hindsight, how deep was the deception that Hamas did on us. Unfortunately, in hindsight, I think that Hamas didn't join the operation in our time, Rise of Dawn, it's the name in English. They didn't join not because they wanted to improve the lives of the Palestinians, but they wanted to the element of surprise when they thought that they were ready. And this is unfortunately probably part of their deception. And that's very problematic to think that someone that we thought we could somehow manage with was actually planning this for such a long time. This is very devastating. Again, this just says how problematic Hamas is as a movement. They should never be allowed to govern people again.
The last thing that I wanted to ask you is if you were advising the government right now, I wanted to understand two scenarios from here. About one is about the hostage crisis. That Hamas has chose to act in a way of releasing a couple of hostages at a time. I think around five hostages, four have been released and one of them has been rescued. With pressure mounting up by the international community and Hamas been mentioning that they will release international hostages. As a government, would you choose to pause the ground operations for a while and allow Hamas to release the hostage and then carry out the operations? That's the first thing I want to ask you. And the second thing I wanted to ask you is, where do you see the end game here? Because probably destroying Hamas will not be an ultimate goal, because the day after, if you come back, there will be a vacuum and more radical forces might come into Gaza. So I don't think the UN would like to keep a peacekeeping force in Gaza as well, because it's not been effective before.
Right. So as for the first question, of course, I would want to prioritize the release of the hostages. But I do not think that by conducting a ceasefire, we increase the chances of receiving the hostages back. On the contrary, I think that Hamas will only do this if they understand that there is a sword very close to their neck, and that the leadership will understand that if they don't release the hostages, they will die themselves. So it's a very delicate balance. If we go for a ceasefire, they win, we don't get the hostages back. They will negotiate and negotiate and negotiate and ask for things that are completely unreasonable. So I don't think this is a good negotiation tactic. As for the end game, look, as I said before, Israel shouldn't go back into Gaza and rule it. We withdrew from Gaza in 2005. And I wouldn't advise the government to go back into Gaza to reoccupy 2.5 Palestinians and try to rule their lives. But Israel cannot allow for a new extreme movement to rise up after Hamas. We'll need different security considerations. We'll need ability to operate in Gaza. We'll need the Egyptians to close the Rafah crossing in ways that armament and other equipment to support terror cannot come through the Rafah crossing into Gaza. We will need a new buffer zone to protect our civilians. There are a host of things we need to do. And also, we need to work with international community so that there will be some kind of civilian, more pragmatic leadership in Gaza that can lead 2.5 Palestinians there. Hopefully, that can happen. If this can't happen, that is bad news. And Israel needs to work toward that end. Otherwise, there can never be a solution to the Palestinian problem. And this isn't good, not for Israel, not for Egypt, not for the Palestinian, not for everybody. Only the extremists win from this situation. And again, you know, it's very difficult now during war to think about how this can play out and how should the process look like. But I can tell you that I think that most of the Israelis still understand, even though that we're very, very angry. And, you know, we hear a lot of revenge comments coming from Israelis. We know that ultimately, there must be some kind of solution to the Palestinian problem. It won't be in the form that people had hoped in the international community. Israel cannot continue to withdraw from territories and hope that things will get better. They don't. We need to be very more careful about our security considerations of what we're having. So I can't give you a better answer than that. I can just tell you that this is something we'll need to deal with, and we have to deal with all the time. And we need to be engaging our friends, both in the Arab countries around us and also with countries like India that can serve as a very, I think, stabilizing force in our region. You know, my conversations with my counterpart in India were very promising. The understanding that India has of the very unique, difficult situation that Israel is within. And hopefully we can create the conditions for better a solution in the future. And until then, we will need to guard our people to better defend them, to make sure that such opportunities would not give our enemies opportunities to attack us so brutally in the future. And we will need to do both.
And is Prime Minister Netanyahu approaching this differently probably than Yair Lapid or Naftali Bennett would have approached it, according to you?
Look, you're asking a very delicate political question, and I will try to answer it carefully. I think that Netanyahu's attempt to push this conflict for him as if this is not his responsibility is doomed to fail. Netanyahu has been prime minister for so long. He's been carving these policies for many years, and he's been in power for almost 10 months when this happened in Israel, 9 months when this happened. And, you know, I think that his attempt to push this away and to say that he does not bear responsibility is doomed to fail. This is not what you expect from your leadership. And I think that this is what I should answer in regards to that.
Well, those are all the questions that I had for you. Thank you so much, sir, for taking your time.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And thank you, your media outlet, and also to the audience and readers that listen to what I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.